30 minutes मैम, 30 minutes। एक्चुअली इट इज रीशेड्यूल टू 30 minutes मैम। अश्विनी मैम, शैल वी स्टार्ट?
यस इंदु मैम, यू कैन।
ओके
ओके, सो पार्टिसिपेंट 34 पार्टिसिपेंट्स आर देयर, राइट?
या 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 या। वंस अगेन, गुड मॉर्निंग टू वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर। वेलकम टू द फिफ्थ डे, द लास्ट डे ऑफ अडल AICTE लर्निंग एकेडमी सपोर्टेड FTP ऑन इफेक्टिव कोर्स डिलीवरी थ्रू मोडल organized by the Department of Computer Applications, MES College, Marampilly. So we are straight away moving on to our session. For that, let me invite Dr. Julie M. David, Assistant Professor, MES College, Marampilly, to welcome our resource person. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Indu. A very good morning to all. First of all, I would like to thank everyone who joined us this morning session. Today is the fifth day of our FDP. Let me take a moment to welcome the resource person of this session, Ms. Ashwathi Goban, who is beyond good expert in this concept. We were able to understand her expertise in the past 2-3 days. I welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Julie, ma'am. Thank you.
Without any further delay, we will go to the session. Thank you. Thank you all.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. Okay, so warm good morning to one and all present here. So I'm audible, right?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. So you are all ready for the, I can say, the last session regarding the Moodle, right? Right? All of you? So can I get a response to good morning or hi in the chat? Yes, Sandeep. Hello. So how are you all? You're all doing good, right? Yes, hello, hello. Okay. So today we are going to see a new feature that can be implemented to the Moodle, that is a virtual programming lab. Okay, so before directly going to the Moodle, I just want you to take to the concept of this Moodle. Okay, that means what is virtual programming lab and what is its use? So that is the first session. What we are going to cover today first, and after that I will take you to the Moodle cloud. Not in the Moodle cloud actually, because you know the VPL, virtual programming lab, is a plugin. Okay, so that you have to install in the LMS, but in the Moodle cloud we don't have any option to install the plugins. Okay, so for that all my explanations today will be in the Pathshala. We already shared some videos how to install the Moodle in your local system, right? Okay, so in that you can install the VPL also. But today I will be explaining with the Pathshala, and we will show you a demo in the Moodle, which is installed in the local system as well. Okay, so first I will just take you to the virtual programming lab concept, the basic concept. What is actually the virtual programming lab, and what is the main benefit from the teacher side and from the student side? Okay, so let me know how many of you have this programming background, or how many of you are handling the programming courses. Can I get a response in the chat? Because I know all of you may not be handling the programming courses, but some of you will be from the programming background and handling the programming courses in your colleges or universities, right? Yes, SPS or no, Laila Man, yes. Okay, yes. Okay, fine. So for those have, or for those who are handling the programming courses, no, it is a very good, beneficial if you are using a virtual programming lab. So that I am going to explain how it will be beneficial for both the students as well as the teachers. Okay, so okay, from a teacher's point of view, I am creating simulated programmers. Okay, Sandeep's are great. Okay, okay. So I just want to ask to those who are handling the programming courses, okay, what are the major challenges when you are facing when you are taking a programming course? I'm not asking a theory course, a programming subject. Suppose you are taking a subject related to Python programming, okay, Java and all. What are the major challenges you are facing if it is an online mode or in the offline mode, what will be the major challenges you will be facing when you are taking a subject related to a program? Can I get a response? I think you won't be facing any challenges, right? You all are well equipped with the, all the systems. I know you are all experienced person. Okay, convert the proper logic. Okay, in lab, when they are saying in lab, yes, lab session, yes. So, okay. So, when coming to the this programming subjects, no? Yes, during the lab session, BBM, in the memo, saying lab session, okay. When coming to this programming course, what's the major challenge? That's theory part as well as the practical part, right? If a student is studying only, if a student is understanding only the theory part, he can't be an excellent in the program, right? He has to get some hands-on experience. He has to do the program, okay? And the most important thing is that they will study the program only when they are facing some errors. Are you agreeing with me? Because no one in this world is perfect in programming, right? Everyone will be facing errors. Yes, sir. Yes, of course. See, when you are getting an error, then only you will understand, okay, this is my error. So you will study from the errors and you will try to overcome this error, right? So that's the way how we can study the program. Okay, so one of the major issues is the hands-on session, right? And coming to the assignment part. Okay, so assignments all are the part of the curriculum, right? In almost all the universities, assignment is a part of the curriculum. It has a weightage in the internal marks, right? So when we are giving some questions or when we are creating assignments related to programming subjects, of course, we will be giving some program questions, right? We don't be more focusing on the theory part. We will be giving some program. So then the students will explore more and study, or they can learn more about this programming part. Okay. So, is there anyone face any issue while giving the assignment? Okay. If I give the assignments related to Python. Okay, there are some 30 questions related to Python, and I am giving the 30 questions to the students as assignment. So then what will be the major issue facing from your teacher's side? And now I'm asking now about the assignment part, not about the teaching part. In the case of assignment, okay, let's imagine if you are giving 30 questions related to Python or any other program as a assignment question to the students. Okay, you have given the questions to the students. Then what will be the major challenge you are facing? You have already given the assignment. Then after that, what is the major challenge you are facing? Evaluation, right, Arun sir? Exactly, the evaluation, right? So why this evaluation is more important? Suppose in a class, imagine there are 60 students in the class. Okay, is it necessary that all the 60 students write the same program for all the 30 questions? Is it necessary that they all build the program in the same way? Is it like that? No, yes, I'll come in. No, right? They will be dealing each program in a different way, in a different logic they will be using, right? So for that, it is a tedious job. For each student, what the teachers have to do? The teachers have to go through this 30 questions. We are giving some 30 questions. Just imagine, okay? The teacher has to go through all these 30 questions, right? And then they have to evaluate. All the 30 answers will be different. And for each answer, for each question, each student will be responding differently, right? They may not be writing the same program. They may not be using the same concept of logic. So all this difference. So the major problem or major challenge facing by the teachers who are handling programming courses in case of assignment, this is the evaluation part. Okay, evaluation is again a serious job for both theory as well as the programming subject, but I'm just focusing on the programming part. Okay, so now this challenges we can overcome with the help of virtual programming lab. Okay, so that's what I am just discussing now. So from the student side also, so now we have some online tools and there, right? If suppose I am giving 30 questions, simply they can write the answers, right? Or it's a digital world, they can write the codes in a notepad or any Word format or anything, and they can upload it as assignment. But they are not sure whether the answer is correct or not. But in this modern world, they have online platforms out there. They can check. Okay, they can check, and then they have to write the programs in the Word document or not that, and then they have to upload in the assignment session, right? But they won't be sure, okay, whether the answer is correct or not, whether it is reaching us or what the correct result, okay? They won't be able to debug the programs at all. But that is one of the problem that is facing by the students then, right? They will be very confusing, okay, how to write this and all, what is the error in that and all, right? So there's a major problem facing from the students end. Then from the teacher's end, of course, it's the evaluation, right? So when the 60 students are submitting 30 questions each, it is a tedious job to evaluate the whole program. So that's the challenges facing from the students end as well as the teacher's end in the case of programming. So these challenges we can overcome in the virtual programming lab. Okay. So here, the next thing what I'm going to show is what are the things that a student as well as a teacher get benefit from a virtual programming lab. Okay. So I already said the virtual programming lab is a plugin. Okay, that can be integrated to the Moodle Cloud. So once it is integrated, you can use this VPL inside the Moodle itself. And the students, okay, the students can write the code inside the Moodle, they can run the code inside the Moodle, and they can evaluate the code inside the Moodle file. So that is the major benefit of virtual programming lab in Moodle. Okay, so I know if I am taking a Python course, several IDEs are there, right? You can write the Python code in Jupyter Notebook, in Spyder, okay? And Google Collab. So like that, in JavaScript also several ideas are there. But in the case of virtual programming lab, if it is installed or it is connected to the Moodle, the students can write their code inside the Moodle itself. They don't want to go anywhere outside. Okay, they can write the code inside the Moodle itself and they can run it. Okay, inside the Moodle itself, they can run it. And if suppose there is any error, they can again edit the program. Okay, there is an option for edit the program. They are not allowed to write the program only once. Okay, they can edit the program and they can correct the error. Okay, and they can go for the evaluation. So the teachers are not evaluating me. The students themselves are going to evaluate the program. Suppose I had such a program out of 10. Okay, the students write the code, run it, and when she evaluates it, no, she is getting only some 5 marks. So what is the next step? She has to check for the error. So where is the error? And she has to correct that error. And after that, she has to again evaluate it. So this process can take place until she gets a full out of, that is 10 out of 10. That is, she when recovers all the errors, until that time, she can edit the program in the Moodle itself. Okay, they don't want to go anywhere outside. That is a major benefit of virtual programming lab when we are using anything in with Moodle. When coming to the teacher side, so obviously, what is the benefit? The teacher don't want to evaluate it, right? So once the student write the code, run it and evaluate it, her evaluation marks will be there. The students themselves evaluate their program. Okay, the teachers don't want to go and take the submissions, each and every submissions, and then evaluate it. Okay, so that's the thing. So these are the things from the student side they can do in a VPL. They can edit the program. They can run the program. Okay. They can run the program and they can evaluate the program. So these are the three things from the student side they can do. Okay, these are the benefits, right? When the students themselves are evaluating, means they are checking whether the program is correct or not. If it is not correct, they can again go and edit it, again run it, and again evaluate. It's actually a loop. Okay, and from the teacher's side, what's the benefit? Evaluation. They don't want to evaluate each and every submissions from the student. The students themselves evaluate, and that evaluation mark we can get from the grade book in Pathshala. Okay, so that's the basic concept behind this virtual programming lab. Okay, is that clear to you all? I didn't mention how to install the VPL or how to use the VPL in Moodle. I am just explaining what are the benefits or how this VPL can be beneficial to both the students as well as the teachers. Is that clear? Yes, Sandeepa says clear. What about others? You're all here, right? See, this is the last session regarding the Moodle. Yes, Alka ma'am. Yes. Okay. Okay, sir. Yes. Okay. So this is the basic concept. And the only thing is now, yes, Renji ma'am. The only thing now, not to set up the virtual lab, it is some time consuming. So initial task is some time consuming and some what is it tedious for a beginner level. It is some confusing is out there. But once it is set up now, it can be used for all the students, or if it is using for the first year students, okay, you can set the questions like that. Okay, that whenever the students come to first year, same questions you can give it for the other students also. Once it is set up, it can be reused again. But the initial setup process is somewhat you should know. Okay, and it is again, see, it is not a completed version of VPL. It is adding so many things. Okay, it is updated actually. So you have to update it with. And once I show how you can set up this VPL in this Moodle, I will just summarize with you the Moodle VPL forum actually. So yesterday we discussed about the forum in Pathshala, right? Okay. So just like that, we have a Moodle VPL forum. Okay. So there you can pause the error. Sometimes the server will be down. So many issues will be there. Sometimes it is not always. Okay. So at that time, it is the best if you are stuck somewhere. Okay. You can pause the query in the Moodle VPL forum that I will show you. So, and as a beginner, okay, if you are trying for a VPL for a beginner, you will be facing so many errors, right? And it is a better way to go and check the forum, because the same error may be facing by some others in the past. They have already posted that query, and there will be a solution also. So I personally prefer that when you are going to implement a VPL for the first time, obviously there will be so many confusions and all. So it is better to go on the forum and refer. It's a very good platform, and if you post a query also, they will be responding back. Okay. Okay, so without wasting time, I'm just moving to the Pathshala. Just give me 1 second. Okay. Screen is visible, right?
Yes, Ashwati, it is visible.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, so actually, this is our Pathshala, our LMS. Okay, I can't show you this in the Moodle Cloud, I already mentioned. So I am going to demonstrate all the experience in the Pathshala itself. Okay, so actually, I want to ask you something. Can you please tell me whether this VPL is an activity or a resource? Can you please tell me whether this VPL, Virtual Programming Lab, is an activity or a resource? We discussed lots of activities.
It's an activity.
Yes, Sandeep sir says it's an activity. Any other suggestion? Or there is any other who is not agreeing with Sandeep sir's suggestion? It's an activity. So all others are agreeing with Sandeep sir, right? It's an activity. Sandeep sir says it's an activity. Obviously, it's an activity. Right, Sandeep sir and SP sir, it's an activity. So because now we are setting something for the students and in return they are submitting right back. So it's an interactive one. The teachers are giving something to the students and in return students will perform some tasks related to their work and they will be submitting it. So obviously it is an activity. So when you are adding this VPL inside your Moodle, it will be in your activity session. Okay. So coming back, I will be showing how to add a VPL. Okay, so I am adding, okay, it is in the edit mode, right? We have to turn, yes, it is already in the edit mode. The first step is you have to turn the editing on. And the next step, you have to, okay, insert any topic or insert any session, you can add the VPL. So right now I am just going to add in the topic 11. Okay, so I will create a new one. I am going to add a new VPL session under topic 11. Okay, so you can click add an activity here. Just give me 1 second. Yes, so add an activity here. So inside the activity, you can see a VPL. Okay, this is virtual programming lab. Here it is, the VPL. So inside this, we can see resource as well as activities, right? But here, the VPL is in the activity session. You can just click VPL. So here, it will just a description of what is a VPL and all. And if you want to know more about VPL, you can go to this virtual programming lab homepage. Okay, so you can add it. You can add it. And you can give, just as I already discussed the assignments, right? It is somewhat similar to assignment, but it is related to some programming concept, okay? I can give the name. Okay, so I'm just writing, welcome to Python. Just, okay, you can give the name right here. And if you want, you can give a short description and you can give the full description here. Here I am going to write a program. Okay, you can write a Python program. See, I know more about Python. That's why I'm concentrating more into Python. So I will show you which all programs can be integrated to VPL. Okay, once I am doing the settings, I will show you. That's why I'm just writing the Python, okay? Okay. So, yes, write a Python program to display. Yes, welcome to the world of Python. Okay, so this is the thing I just want to do. Okay, I need the student. Okay, I will change this. Okay, so I just need the student to write a program so that it will print welcome to Python as the output. Simple program. Okay, now I'm not going much deeper into the programming concept at all. I just need a student to write a program. It can be any program. That program list I will show you. In Python, they have to display welcome to Python. Okay. If you want, you can display it in the course page. I think you all know that. And a submission period. Okay. The submission period also you can set from which date it will be available from. Okay. And the due date also they can. If it is available from, suppose I am giving 17th September, the due date again 25th September, anything. That is according to you. So that time only the students will be able to write the code, run it and evaluate it. Okay. So students can access this VPL program from 17 September 9:29 a.m. to 25 September 5:30 a.m. Okay, so I think you all know this. And the submission criterion. Okay, the submission criterion here, the maximum number of files. The maximum number of files in the sense, the number of files in which the students can write the program. So it is set to 1. And the type of work is the individual work. Okay, if you want to change the group work, it can also change. But we before that, you have to create a group, okay? But now I am not going for the group work. It is all as an individual work. And the grade. So the grade indicates how much marks you are going to assign to this particular program. Suppose you are setting an assignment for 10 marks. Okay, so in that case, you are giving 5 programs. Each program carries 2 marks. So in that case, this is the first program, right? So you have to change this to 2. Whatever grade you are using, you can use. Suppose I am giving 10. This program will be graded out of 10. That's it. And here, the grade category. If you created a grade book, I think you all remember, right? You can create a grade book including all the categories, example, clusters, assignments, okay? If you want to add this particular VPL program into assignment part, right now, I didn't create a grade book here. That's why you are not able to see any categories here. But if you already created a grade book and if you want to add this program to any of the categories, for example, assignment, you can select it from this drop-down button. Okay, all the settings are somewhat similar. Only a few things are different. Okay. And the grade to pass, obviously, the total mark is out of 10. And if you are setting a pass mark, okay, so in the grade book, it will be reflected. Say she got it marks only 4, that 4 will be highlighted in the red color. Okay, right now I'm not giving any pass mark. and reduction by automatic evaluation. So this things you can fit that I will tell you. I already mentioned that in a virtual programming lab, a student can do the editing, running and evaluation as many times as possible, right? That's the default concept. That is by default. Okay. And you can't set the number of evaluations. Suppose you want a student, okay, to access this virtual program to run, edit, and evaluate only for 5 times. You can't set like that. Okay, the number of evaluations is actually infinity. They can access it, that means they can run it, they can edit it, and they can evaluate it as many times they can want. But the one thing you can set, that is the free evaluation. And after that, you can penalize the marks. Okay, suppose I am setting here the number free evaluations 3. Okay, so free evaluation is set. First time they can write the program, okay, they can run it and they can evaluate it. Suppose think that there is an error, they want to change it. So the one attempt is over, right? So second attempt, they will try to reduce the error. Again, they edit the program, again they run it, okay, and then again evaluate it, but again error is there. So 2 attempts over, right? Again, third attempt, they are trying to write the code again, evaluate it, means run it and evaluate it, but again error. Okay, so 3 attempts over. The maximum free evaluation you are setting is 3. Okay, and after that also they can do it. After 3 attempts also they can run it, they can edit it, and they can evaluate it. Okay, these 3 options are available, but you can reduce the marks for the other evaluation. Okay, you can reduce. Suppose I am writing 10%. Oh, sorry. Here. Okay, suppose it is 10%. That means the first 3 times, okay, the students will be getting the free option. They can run it, they can edit it, run it, and evaluate it. No problem. No marks will be reduced if the program is incorrect. Okay, but if they are trying more than 3, means for every try, a 10% marks will be reduced from the total marks. That means total is out of 10, right? So like this, you can set. Okay, I think it's clear, right? Do you understand my concept?
Well, ma'am, but in that case, one thing I want to understand, like if we are reducing it by 10%.
Yes.
And if the student gets it done in 4th attempt, then he will get 90% marks, right? Out of 10, yes, he will get,
yes,
9.
Yes.
But if he goes for the 9th, for the 5th attempt,
yes,
so the 10% will be reduced of the 10 marks or will be of the remaining marks? Is it
the remaining marks actually?
So it means the next time it will be reduced, 10% would be 0.9%, like, yeah, 0.9. Yeah. Okay.
Yes.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
Yes. So right now I'm not setting this, okay? Because we don't, we just add this program not for a assignment or anything. There is one platform, the DPL helps to make the students to understand the Python more, any program. Okay, so if you want to give us an assignment, you can give us an assignment. If suppose you are teaching the students or the first year students, okay, they don't have any programming background, they are new to the programming concepts and all, right? So for that, for the studying purpose also, we can give this particular DPL. Okay, at that time, you don't want to take the grade for the assessment, you just give this DPL for them to study. That may be interesting, right? They can study from the errors, they can do the coding and all. But it is better if you are giving, if suppose you are in a college, okay? There are some 500 students using the programming code and they are all using the DPL, maybe your server is good now, okay? So it is better in that case, you can set the free evaluation and the grade penalty, that is a grade reduction also. So that your students may not be using so many times, right? So after 3 attempts, they will think, okay, where is my error? They will start to think. If we are giving free evaluations continuously, what happens? They will try and do. Yes, nice thing. Yeah, it is not in the Moodle Cloud actually, sir. I don't know if that's it. It is not available in the Moodle Cloud because it's actually a plugin, okay? We can't add plugins to Moodle Cloud. So that's it, sir. I think Madhav sir asked, right? Yes, Satnam is right. Yes. So, in my opinion, if it is you are using this DPL in the whole college or anything, okay, when it will be a problem to your server when the large number of users are using this. Okay, in that time, you can set the pre-evaluations and the grade reduction so that the students will be more careful, right? So they have only 3 free attempts. So after that, they will be careful. Okay, they will be more keen to not to make any errors. Okay, so that's the one thing that you can try. And the next other thing, the other thing we can set is the restrict access. I think already Google mentioned how to restrict access. If you want, we want to make it available for a particular group of students and all, you can use the restrict access method. And this is the major things, okay? This is the main things we have to set. There is a name, description, then the availability from, okay? So that submission period session also you have to set, and the grade session. Okay, the grade session, like how many marks you are giving for this particular program, and how if you want to give pre-evaluation, okay, if you want to set pre-evaluations and penalty for the other one, you can set in this particular setting. So after that, you can create this. Okay, save and return to the course. So that particular VPL session will be created under topic 11 for me, right? Under topic 11, there is a, so this is a symbol for VPL. Okay, so welcome to Python. So now we are going inside that. So now what is happening is that we just set a question, right? We just set a question. So we have to move forward also. So here they can see, okay, available from 5-day due date, maximum number of files and the individual work, the grade is 10. And here you can see this one. This is run, evaluate, no. Okay, so as of now, the students will be able to only write that program. They can't be able to run it and evaluate. So that's the thing we have to change. Okay, so that is the next thing we are going to do. So for that, so here you can see the page settings, right? There's an option here, page settings. So there you can see the execution options will be there. Execution options, okay? So you can go to the execution options. So this is also one important thing. Okay, this based on, it is not a need, it's not a compulsory. This run script, okay, you can see it is auto detect. But here in this drop down, you can see the program that's supported by the VPL. So these are the list of programs the VPL supports. So VHDL is there, Verilog is there, TypeScript, SQL, Shell, Kim, Scala, RunPy, R is there, Python, different versions available, PHP, Perl, Pascal, so many programs are there. So here you can see the list of programs, okay, which this VPL supports. Okay, you can go to the execution options and check. And if I'm setting, suppose this is my Python program, right? I'm writing the Python. If you can set like this, this will be in the Python 3 version. But if you are setting in an auto detect mode, what happens? The VPL will automatically detect which type of program is handling from the file extension. If suppose I am writing a Python program, the file extension will be .py, right? Okay. So from the file extension, it will automatically detect which type of program it is using. Okay. And there's no need to change it to auto detect. If you want, you can change, no issues. Otherwise, it will automatically detect which type of program is handled. And coming to the next one, the main option you have to change is the run option. Okay. So the run option is no. That means now the students won't be able to run the code which they have written. So I have to change to yes. So the students can now run the program. So here in this session, I won't be going more deep into this VPL. Okay. So I'm not taking more into the debug session at all. For the debug session, you have to write again the code. So I'm not going much depth into that. So now, as of now, I am just the basic thing that the student can write the code. Now she can run it, right? The run option is enabled. And the evaluation also user you have to set. So now the student can run it and evaluate it. And it is automatically graded. It also has to be shipped to. Okay, so whenever she want to evaluate it, automatically that grade should be displayed. So that's the meaning. So this session, we have to be very careful. Otherwise, the students may not be able to run and evaluate. Okay, they will be able to write the code, obviously, but may not be able to run and evaluate. So this particular setting we have to do. If you want, you can set this run script option to the corresponding program you are using. Otherwise, leave it to auto-detect, not true. And this one, this run option, evaluate option, and the automatic grade option, you have to set and you have to save the option. Okay, so the option has been again, I am going back to this particular program. Okay, so now this is already set. Now my question is, we already set, okay, we set the question and we change all the settings such a way that the students can write the program, they can run it, and they can evaluate. Next, my question is, how to evaluate it? See, we only write a question, right? We only, from the teacher's side, we only write a question and we make the settings in such a way that the students can write it, run it, and evaluate it. Obviously, for writing it, there will be a file opening will be there. And for running also, it will run in the particular language, particular program. It will detect the particular program and it will run in the console. Okay, that's fine. But how to evaluate it? We already set a marks out of 10, okay? The program, the written by the students have to get evaluated. So how we can evaluate it? Any idea? From the teacher side, we have to do something, right? We have to
set it. It says automatic grade. We set the automatic grade on.
Yeah, automatically it will display the mark, but on that basis it will grade.
I'm sorry?
It should grade automatically.
Right.
But on what basis it will grade? We have to set some criteria, right?
Okay.
That's what I am asking. See, here I just given only the description, right? You have to write the program to display welcome to Python. So from the description, this VP will not understand, right? What's the program and all, and how to only we have to set some criteria. Okay, if the output is like this, give the 10 marks. Otherwise, 0 marks. Right? Yes. Sridevi, sir, we can give some sample input and all.
Can you please log in from the student log account? And you can also run this program so that I can.
Yeah, that we will show, sir. Once the system is over, I will show you, okay? Because I didn't complete the settings to the teacher side. That's why. Once it's over, I will show you from the student side how it is looking. Okay, fine. So this is actually one thing we want to do. Our teacher side setting is not over. Now we are going to the crucial setting, that is, we are going to set the evaluation settings, that is the test cases. Okay, we are writing some cases. Okay, for this input, this will be the output. Or we are setting the cases for this, when the student is running the particular program, she should get this particular output. Right. So that is very, very important. That is actually the most important part of this virtual programming lab. Then only it can evaluate it, right? So once the student writes it and once the student runs it, after that, when she is evaluating it, actually what is happening? This VPL is taking this test cases and this VPL will put this test cases into the program written by the student. Okay, if she is getting the correct output for the test cases, then she will get a full mark. Okay, so that's the thing. And when you are setting the test cases, you will be very, very careful. The test cases should cover all the possibilities. All the possibilities in the sense, if I am, I am asking to write a program, okay, to check whether the three numbers are, to check the largest of three numbers. Okay, just imagine. I am just asking to check whether which number is largest among the three numbers. Okay, so just imagine. Okay, not a, okay. In some cases, students may be dealing only with positive numbers, right? Obviously, all of you will be writing the program. It satisfies only the positive numbers, but in that case, if you are writing a program, it should satisfy the general condition, right? So if I am giving a negative number also, that program should display which is the smallest or the largest number. So like that, you have to set the test cases. So So when you write the test cases, it should cover all the situations. Okay, whether it is when all the numbers are positive, what will be the output? When there is a positive and negative numbers, what will be the output? When there are only negative numbers, what will be the output? So all the conditions should be included in the test case. So that is very, very important. I think it's clear, right? What is the use of test cases? That I will demonstrate all of you, but I am just telling what is the use of test cases. For evaluating a program from the student side, the teacher should provide a test case. Okay, so the VPL will run the program written by the student using the test case. So that is another important thing that you have to do. So for that, again, you have to go to the page settings. There is an option called test case. There's an option known as test case. Okay. So test cases, there's a format for writing the test cases. We have to write case equal to. Okay, case equal to test one. You can give any name, test one. Okay. So this is the first case we are writing. For every case, the keyword starting should be case. So you can write multiple cases, but every case should start with the keyword case. Okay, and you can tell what is the input and what is the corresponding output. But here in my program, I am going to display the world of Python, right? Welcome to Python, right? Welcome to Python. So is there any case of input we are recommending? Is there a need to suggest any input? Can I get a response from those who are in the programming side? See, I am going to write a case, okay? So in the case, is there any need to specify the inputs? The program is to display welcome to Python. No, Divya main says no, okay? What about others? This is simple, right? Not go depth into any programming. I'm just asking. We are going to write a program to display welcome to Python. Okay, so there is no need of input, right? The student is just printing welcome to Python. So there is no need to display or no need to set the input. You have to set the output like this. Okay, you can say output is equal to, okay, output is equal to, in double quotes, I'm writing welcome to Python. So this is the way I am writing. Okay. This welcome spelling is right? Welcome. Oh my God. Okay. Now it's correct, right? Yes. So now this is the case I have written. Okay. This is the only case. I don't want to check any other case. Okay. If the program run by the student, okay, it is executed and is getting the output, welcome to the Python, she will get 100% score. That is, she will get a 10 out of 10. Can you tell me why I am specifying it in double quotes? I specify this text, that is welcome to Python, in double quotes, right? Why? Can anyone tell me? Yes, Divya ma'am, it is case sensitive. It is case sensitive. Okay, it is case sensitive. Okay, can anyone tell me why I have given it in the double quotes?
Well, that is, I think that is a placeholder where, like, we need this value to be handled by the operator, like output.
Yes, if the output is like this, I am removing this, okay? Then it was also a test case actually. But there is some difference when it is, we are specifying the output in double quotes and without the quotes. I'm asking, yeah, Sapna says it is a string, yes. It is now also the string, right? Can anyone tell me? I will tell you. Suppose I am writing this output is equal to welcome to Python. Okay, it will check. Okay, in the output, anywhere there is welcome to Python is displayed. Okay, anywhere in the output. But if I am specifying it in the double quote, that means exactly that should be the output, no other things should come in the output. Exactly that text should be in the output. That is, the output should be only welcome to Python. Is that clear? Is that clear what the difference? If you're putting in a double quote, that means exactly that text should be in the output of a student program or the output of a program. If you're not specifying that double quote, means that word can be anywhere in the output. Not an issue. If it is Python to welcome or to welcome Python, the order is in the disorder also, it will show the 100% score. That's the problem. Okay, so there is something you have to study more on the how to write a test case. That is actually tricky. Okay, so that is one place where you have to gain experience. Okay, if you want an exact text, you have to provide it in the double quote. Or you want the text anywhere in the output, you can simply write the text, not an issue. Okay, so this is the one way you have to write the test cases. Okay, so right now, yes. So right now, in this Pathshala, we are facing some server issue from the VPL actually. So I am not able to save it. So once you have write the test cases, you can save it. Okay, but right now it is facing some issue in the VPL. So once, but what you have to do is, once you have to write a test case and save it, but don't worry, we will demonstrate all this in the what Moodle once we are installed in the local system. Okay, no issues. I'm just explaining the steps. Okay, so these are the things we have to do initially. First, you have to do the settings, the name of the program, name of the VPL, the description, the submission time, and the grade settings and all. Okay, now you can see the run option and the evaluation option is enabled, right? So second is, you have to change the execution option. From the page settings, we have to show you. From the page settings, we have to change the execution option. You can set whether the student has the ability to run, evaluate, or automatically grade their program. Then, in order to grade it, you have to set some test cases. So that is in the test cases available here. Okay, and one more thing. So initially you set up the program, right? If you want to edit anything, you can go to the edit section. If you want to change the grade, if you want to change the description, if you want to change the submission period and all, you can do it here. Okay, so these are the main three parts you have to concentrate when you are dealing with the VPL. The major thing is the test cases. Okay. So the test cases is going to play a very important role. And I will show you from a previous program. Okay, so this is how you can set up a VPL in Moodle. Then here I already set some programs. Okay, this is some of the programs we have already set for the Python, okay, in the Pathshala. So I will just show you. Welcome to the world of Python. Okay. Okay, so here it is. Here it is, the welcome to the world of Python. And here you can write the test cases. Then you have written the test cases and you have written everything, right? Then if you want to check whether it is running or not, whether you want to check, there's a test activity here. I think I will show you once more. See, you have written all the description, you have written all the settings, you enable the debug run and option, you all written the cases. Then you want to check whether the cases are good or not to go, right? So in that case, there's a provision for test activity. There's a provision for test activity. So click the test activity. Okay. There you can see an edit tab. Okay, you can see an edit tab here. Okay. So here you can write the code. So this is a place where you can write the code. Okay, so this hello.py is a file where we can write the code. So here, if I'm writing print world of Python, what happens? It will be saved. And this is the icon for running the program. Okay, once you set up all the things, you can check whether your VPL settings are good to go or not. You can go to the text activity. You can go to the edit tab and you can write a program here. Okay, so this is the run tab. This flight symbol is there, right? This is the run tab. So what happens? It will be running. So it will run the program in a console and it will be written World of Python. Okay. So every student, the student view, I will show you how it will be. For every student, there will be a tab like this. Okay. So there will be a file like this, hello.py. And they can write the code in that file and they can run it. So the console will be opening and showing World of Python. Okay. And after running it, they can evaluate it. I will also show you how to evaluate. So this
outcome is not matching.
Pardon?
You have written as an outcome, welcome to Python.
Yes,
but
yes.
Message is printing bird of Python.
Yes, I'm just showing the error.
Sorry?
I am just trying to show the error, okay? I'm not writing the correct program, I know. Okay. See, whatever be the program written by the student, it will be get run. Okay, it will run and it will produce some output in the console. Whatever be the output, it will be displayed. Okay, that is what I meant to convey you. Okay, whatever be the program, if it is a correct or not or anything, whatever the student is writing, accordingly, the output will be displayed in the console. There is no issue regarding that. Okay, the only thing is in the evaluation part. Okay, the student can evaluate it here. The same thing from the student end also, I will show you. The same thing, a file like hello.py will be opening in the student end and they can write the program here and they can save it and they can run it and they can evaluate. So when coming to evaluation, okay, so right now there is no test cases. So it is showing that no test case form. Okay, so it is graded as 0 out of 10. If it satisfies the test cases, it will show 10 out of 10 or anything. Okay, so this is the way they can run it. And one more thing I missed out is, you'll be wondering this hello.py, where it comes from, right? Are you wondering about that? I didn't mention about this hello.py. How will it be coming? Ma'am, so forth, memory corporate also, we have to give it double quotes. No, Divya, ma'am, that I will show you. I am just discussing a program in which we have to display text in the output. Okay, the next one, I will show you what happens, how to write the test cases for a numeric output. Okay, not an issue. Okay, so this hello.py is a file set by the teacher side itself. That again, you have to go to the page setting. Is the requested file option there. Okay, requested file option is there. So requested file option is a template actually. That means we are creating a file that is already I created hello.py. So a pop-up will be opening that is not showing. So you can write hello.py. Okay. So at that time, this is a template or this is a portion where the students are going to write their code. Okay. You can see the extension hello.py. This hello, you can give any name. Hello, first program, second, anything name you can do. But the extension should be correct. Here the .py I had given because it's a Python program. From the extension, the ZPL is detecting, auto-detecting which program is this. Okay, so this is a place where the students will be able to write their coding. Okay, so these are all about the settings. I just discussed a program in order to display a text option. All the settings we have to done, all the execution options we have to done. The major thing is the test case. Okay, so here, this is from the teacher's point of view. And now I would like to demonstrate how the settings from this Moodle, local installed Moodle. So for that, Rishu, are you there?
Yes, Ashwati. Ashwati, we did a slightly different thing. You can show the demo server, the internal server, and it is up and running. You can log on to that particular server and show it.
Okay, can the I other, that?
Yeah, you just log in. And if you set it up, let me know.
Okay, which is, I forgot that username has one, right?
I'll share you.
Okay. So by that time, is there any query related to this? Any query related to this?
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, Divya ma'am.
In this case, we have set the test case, na?
Yes.
Then why it's not evaluating?
Yeah, it is not tested because I already showed the already developed program, right? There are no test cases are written here. I will show you once. I will go to this demo link, okay? Because from that Parshala side, the server is down actually from yesterday night onwards. Unfortunately, okay. I can't able to show this. So that's why, okay? I will demonstrate it in the next one.
Okay, ma'am, thank you.
Yes, sir. Should I share the credentials, please?
Yes, yes, sir. I got it. Just give me 1 second, okay? Let me log into that. Okay, now I will share the screen.
Well, I'm sorry.
Yes.
I'm sorry. Okay. Will you be also showing that which plugin we need to connect to, you know, use this?
Yeah, that I will show you. Okay. It is available in the Moodle plugin directory, I already mentioned, right?
Right, right.
Yeah, from that, if you're just searching Virtual Programming Lab, there's only one plugin.
Okay.
I think the screen is visible, right?
Yes, Ashwati.
Yes. Okay, I will add a new topic here, that is BPL, okay? So I will show you
the other demo course. It is there, we added it in the demo course, the Python course.
Okay.
Right. I can show that, it's the demonstration is already done, right? Now you, so it's there course. In the settings, you can get the courses, right top.
Okay, fine.
To the left of the profile, that icon will lead to that. Okay, site home. We need it in a slightly different web since it's a demo.
Okay, fine. First time, yeah, it's this year.
That's the course that you created.
yeah. Okay, fine. Okay, so same thing, okay? We have added. So I am just adding a new topic here. Add topic. So I will be demonstrating everything from the initial one, okay? And if you want, you can change the topic name, that is VPL. Okay, we are going to add an activity, that is the Virtual Programming Lab. Okay, the whole thing I will be again, okay, so you can understand once more. Again, I am going to write, okay. Welcome program to display. Welcome to Python. Okay. I'm not going to much more. The submission restrictions, not submission period. Due date is enabled. Okay. And the grade, if you want, you can change. I'm going to 10. I'm not restrict the evaluations. Okay. Okay, save and display. Okay, so this much we have done, right? And the next thing I already mentioned to you, that is we have to go and change the execution options. There's no need to change the run script and all, only the run. Yes. Evaluate. Yes. Automatic grade. Yes. Okay. And we have to save the option. And from here, you can go to this particular program. So now, you please check whether your run and evaluation option is correct. Okay. The next is the test cases, right? So next is the test cases. Okay, so here we are going to write the test case equal to test one. We are getting the output equal to, okay, what is the output I had given? The correct output I will show, okay? So it is welcome to Python, right? Okay. So this is a test case I am writing. So this is the output. There is no input in this case. I am just writing the output. Okay, this is the output I will need. And you just want to save it. Okay, now it's going. Now it's not issued to the server. Thank you, Rujita, for this. Okay, so now the test case is saved. Okay, now you can go back to this page. And you need a file to write the program, right? The last program, you say hello.py. The same way. You have to create a file so that you have to go to the page setting, requested file. So this is actually a template format. So, okay, this is what I am saying. Okay, initially, they will be asking to give a name of the file. So I am just giving welcome is a name, .py. So be careful when you are giving the extension. Okay, .py is very important. Okay, this is the extension you have to give. Then you have to click. Okay, so this is, the file is ready. So this is the place where the students and you will be going to write the program. So this next settings we have to do initially, the general settings, the execution options, the test cases and the file. Okay, so this from the student side also, they will be viewing this file where they can write a program and load. Okay, okay, then coming to this, okay, it is not saved. It's saved, okay. Now again, going back. Now I will show you how to check. Okay, this is the correct one or not. Go into the test activity. There you can see. Now there is no submission because I didn't submit it yet. Go to the edit tab. Go to the edit tab. There you can see that requested file, right? It is welcome.py. And in the right side, there is a description. The program to display. Welcome to Python. Okay, so now I am going to write the code here. So it is from the teacher's side, you are going to test. Okay, once you create all, you have to test whether the program will be satisfying all the test cases or not. Okay, it is working properly or not. You have to test before you have to give to the students. So I am just writing print. Okay. Welcome to Python. Okay, so after writing this, I think it's clear. It is actually just a statement in Python. Okay, so I'm just saving it. Only after saving, you will be able to run and evaluate it. Okay, before that, this all tabs are inactive. So once you write a program or once you edit it, you have to save it. Okay, then only that changes will get affected. After saving it, you can run it. So it will give you giving the output in the console. Welcome to Python. Okay, just I'm just closing it. Then I am going to evaluate it. I'm going to evaluate it. It is giving 0 out of 10. Okay, it is graded 0 out of 10. If what you can see, this comments and all in a better way. Come into the submission view. It is given. Test one, okay. The grade option. You can see, like, see, it's the incorrect program. The program output is welcome to Python, but the expected output is welcome to Python. So there is one test we have written and the 0 test passed. Okay, so that's what we are not able to get the 10 out of 10. Can anybody tell me what is why, what is the error in the program? I'm not asking the in-depth to the, okay. I am not asking in-depth to the program. I'm just asking, okay, it is already displayed here. The program output is welcome to Python, but expected output is welcome to Python. What is the error here? Can anyone tell me?
There is a full stop. There is an
expected point in the last of the line.
Yes, that's correct. Yes, thank you all. So that is the thing I mentioned you in the double quotes, right? Okay, in the test cases, I mentioned in the double quotes. In that, I have mentioned this full stop also. That means exactly in that case itself, the output should be coming. If there is no full stop, it will be showing this grade reduction. Okay, so that is actually what happened. So we can go back to the edit tab. Again, I am going to the edit tab. You can edit it as many times as you want. You can edit it just like the student did. You can edit it. I'm just making a full stop here. Then after editing, you have to save the changes. Okay. And you can evaluate it. If you want to run, you can run it. No issue. Before running also, you can evaluate it. Because this evaluation is not depending upon the output, right? It all depend upon the test case. Okay. And we can evaluate it. It's not showing what happens. Let me check. Welcome. Yeah, welcome to Python is correct only, right? Okay. Let me check with the other one. Let me check the test cases once more, okay? There is a space or something.
I think the period, the dot is outside the quotation. Let's check.
Yeah, let me check, sir. Let me check the test cases once more. Yes, welcome to this world of Python. So that's the thing, okay? If you are setting the test case also, you should be very careful. There, I am not able to edit.
No, I think it's inside, right?
Yeah, it is inside that, sir. Yes. Okay. So I will just go to and edit the test cases once more. Okay, let me check. Okay, that's VTL. Again, you have to edit settings, okay? Okay, from there you have to go to test cases here only. Okay, the test cases I am not showing right now, sir. I don't know what is the issue. There is something issue in the
actually, ma'am. It's in the page settings.
Yes, the page settings is not displaying here. That's why there is something problem, right, sir? Are you able to see the page settings, Vimal? It's not here, right?
Yes, actually, it's in the left. Down to corner.
Let me check my chat is open. Yes, it's here, right? Yes. Okay. My chat window was open. That's why I'm not able to see this. Okay. Welcome to Python. It is the right time. Let me check. Okay. Go to the program. Test activity, edit, welcome to Python, there is no space, yes, now it's getting, so the thing is that there isn't format, I just missed it. So the test activity, I will again show you. So now, can you see the 10 out of 10 score, guys? There's a grade here. Okay, so here you can see the grade is 10 and the summary of the test is one test run and one test pass. Are you able to see this? Now it's showing the correct output, right? Are you able to see this? Now you understand how to test it. Can I get a response? Yes. Okay. So the most important thing is the test case. Okay. The most important thing is the test case. And I wish once there are so many things you can do in the VPL. Okay, so now I will just change in into the switch role to the student.
Actually, I created a student and shared the credentials. You can log out and log in as a student.
Okay, so I.
Otherwise, you use a private window and come out. Sorry.
Okay, I just log out. So I will just log in as a student in, okay, and I will check you. So let me log in, okay.
My user Praveen, Praveen.
Okay, I got
password. No, oh, you got it.
Okay. Okay, so this is the student view. Okay, this is the student view. So from there, this is the course, the Python programming demo course. Okay, so he will be having all these contents. We created a session VPL, right? VPL. This is the program we have created. And the student end, they can see like this. Okay, so they can be seen like this. And they not need to submit any file. If they want, they can submit a file as well. Okay, because there's option for that. But we are not entertaining that because we are asking the student to edit or to write the code inside the VPL, run it and edit it there itself. Okay, so you can see the edit tab, right? The edit tab. Edit tab. There you can see the welcome.py. See, this is welcome.py. This is a file we have created. Okay, so this is the file we just created when we set up the VPL. Okay, so this file, they can write the program. So again, I am writing the same program, print welcome to Python. Okay, with the full stop I am writing. I am just saving it. Okay. And I am, if you want, you can run it. Okay. I'm just going for evaluating it. Not an issue. Yes, it's showing turn off effect. Okay. So we can see from the submission view, it is 10 out of 10. Okay. So the grade is 10 out of 10. This is reviewed on this grade. Okay. And if suppose, if I am again going to the edit button, okay, and I am just changing, okay, just think after getting 10 out of 10, I am just changing this program and just saving it. I am just evaluating it. I am getting a, what will be the score? I will be getting 0 out of 10, right? Yes. Then can you tell me which score will be taken as a gradebook? In the gradebook, which score will be taken? The first attempt, I got 10 out of 10. And the second attempt, I got 0 out of 10. Okay, which score will be taken to the gradebook? Can anyone know that? See, I am logging as a student, right? So as from a student end, she attempts twice. And the first time she got 10 out of 10, but she want to explore more and just change the code. And the second time she got 0 out of 10. So which score will be added to the gradebook? Whether 10 will be added or 0 will be added? Any idea? 10. I'll come and say 10. What about answers?
Well, I think we need to actually mention it in our VPL when we are setting it up, that which grade it should take.
But actually, we can't set like that because VPL itself is set like that. We can't change that. Okay, internally, VPL is set in such a way that it will take the last score, not 10. It is not taking the highest score. Okay, this is one thing you have to please mention to the students. Okay, which one is the last score? Suppose we are opening the assignments for 5 days. Okay, they will be trying and they will be exploring more. Okay, they will try to change the codes and all. The initial time they get some 8 out of 10 and the second time 6 out of 10 or anything. And then 10 and the last they vote is 7 out of 10. Okay, and after that the submission period is over. So the last score will only be taken to the gradebook. So that is also one important thing. That is nothing what we can do. This is actually set in the VPL. Okay. So that is also one of the important things that I want to tell you people. Is that correct? Is that everything okay till now? The test cases writing you have to more know. That is the thing. Okay. Because in this case we know, okay, this is the correct output. This is, will be the output the students will be printing. So exactly you can give the output in the double quotes. But it won't be the case for all the programs, right? So how to write the test cases, you have to understand. Okay, up to this, is there any doubt or anything? I will show you how to go with the numerics and all. But as of now, is there any doubts or anything you want to ask me? The settings you have to study. Okay, just as assignment, initial stage is very simple. The submission date, description and all. Then the thing is execution options you have to set. Okay, and the third thing is the test cases. It is a very, very important test cases. And the last thing, you have to create a file for the students to write the program. That is in the that is a requested file. Okay, so that you create a file with the correct extension. So that particular file, so here you can see, here I already created it, welcome.py. So that file will be available for the students to write the code. Is that clear? Can I get a response? Is it clear or not? Any doubts or anything? Can I get a response, a quick response? Yes, and this answer is yes. What about others? See, you understand completely when you do the hands-on, okay? When you try to do yourself, when you try to do a program, okay? When you try to set up a VPL by yourself, then you are trying to write a test cases. See, initially, when you are writing test cases, it won't be correct. Okay, when you write the test cases, okay, write the test cases, then go to test activity and try it yourself, whether the test cases are satisfying, whether it is working properly or not. Okay, you have to try all the cases, almost some 2 to 3 logics you have to try, because the students may not be writing the same program, right? They will be writing in a different way. Suppose this one, or I will show you. So this one, the same thing, the student is writing available A equal to. I'm just copying, okay? I am assigning it to the variable. I am just printing A. This is also correct, right? The output will be correct. See, it will be printing welcome to Python. The same thing, but in a different way. Okay, so here we don't have the full stop, right? Okay, let me put a full stop also. Save it. Okay, so same thing, but in a different way. So we are going to evaluate it. Yes, it is showing 10 out of 10. So that case we have to think. That is what I am saying. The initial setup phase of the VPL is somewhat, I'm not saying it is difficult, but you should know how to set the test case. Is that clear? Can I go to the other part, how to set the numbers and all? So only this one I am just showing, okay? The others I are already set up, and I will just show the test cases and all, what's the difference and all. Okay. Can I move? Okay, can I check the chat? Okay, VPL is for programming only. Okay, fine. Yes, it is for that. Yes, it's only for programming, Alka, ma'am. I already mentioned which all programs it support, right? You can access it from the execution options. You can access which all programs can be enabled used in this VPL. Okay, fine. So I will just show you some other examples. Okay, I'm not going into create it and all. I will just show you what the difference between creating the test case. Okay, and I will just show you some other one, that is the pattern printing. Okay, the pattern printing. So the question is, write a program to print the following pattern. I think it's visible, right?
Yeah, it's actually.
Okay, so this is a pattern which should be getting the output. So how you can get it? You can give it as an exact text option, right? Right? Are you all agreeing with me? Because the exact way you have to get that pattern, right, in the output. Are you agreeing with me or not? This is the pattern which the students have to print in the outputs. Are you getting me? Okay, so this is the test cases. So case one, and here I am introducing a new term, grade reduction. Okay, grade reduction, that I will tell you. And here I am specifying output is like this. So in the multiple lines I am writing, okay? So here in the same way, what is the pattern you have to get? The first line, a single aspect. So a single aspect in the first line, and the second line, two aspects without space. Okay, and the next line 3 as 6, then 4 as 6. So exactly what you want in the output, in that way itself you have to give it in a double quotes. Then it will check whether the output of a student or the program written by a student is providing exactly the same output. Okay. Then can anyone tell me what is grade reduction? This is one another new term, right? I didn't introduce you before grade reduction. Grade reduction means it is 100% grade reduction. That means the meaning is that if the student program is not getting exactly the same outputs, reduce 100% mark. That means if a student is not getting exactly the same output, the grade will be 0. No other grade will be there. Okay, so the grade will be either 0 or the maximum grade. The maximum grade that's here is 100. Okay, it is not 10, it is 100. So here, if the program, if the student writes a program and that program is displaying this exact same output, you will get a 100% score. That means a score of 100. If the program is not giving this particular exact output, what will be the score? 0. That means it will reduce 100% score. That is 0. So the only case here is the student can score either a 0 mark or 100. So here you can change it. Okay, I will show you how to change the grade reduction in some other cases. So this is one other case where you can use the text option, exact text option. You can write the output in double quotes. Okay, then coming to the other one, numbers. Someone asked me about numbers, right? Okay, let me check. Okay, largest of three numbers. So largest of three numbers means what? The students have to give three numbers, and from that the program should display which is the largest one. So this is a case where you have to deal with numbers, right? Numbers. So the same thing, the only case is that there's a difference in the test cases. The other things are same. We have to go to the edit settings, we have to give the description, submission date, then grade and all. Then you have to go to the execution options, run, debug, grade, you have to set, and you have to go to the request file and you have to create a file. And the test cases, there is some differences there. Are you able to see the test cases? Can I get a response? Are we all fed up with this detail? Okay. So can anyone tell me what is the case one indicate? Case one. This is the whole is the case one. This whole is the case one. Here I have written three cases. This is the case one. This is the case two. And this is the case 3 as in 4 cases. Okay. And here you can change this case 4 actually. Okay. Not an issue. So here I will change it. Execution option. Okay. So here, can anyone tell me what does that actually mean? Here cases, you can see some input is there, some output is there. What is exactly that? Can anyone tell me? The last one, we didn't mention any input, right? The test cases, we mentioned only the case, grade reduction and the output. But here we have said something that is input also. Can anyone tell me what is that? What is the meaning of that? Input 3, 5, 10, output 10.0. What is the meaning? No meaning. Maximum number. It is not the maximum number. Maximum number output. Yes. So here we are writing the test cases. So here comes the actual test cases. Okay. So here, if I am getting input is required. Yes, we get enough. Input is required. Here is the largest of three numbers, right? So obviously there should be three numbers. From that three numbers, we are checking which one is the maximum. Okay. So the case one, I will take the case one. So case equal to test one, you can give a name. Grade reduction 100% means if this case fails, reduce the 100% mark. Okay. Then input equal to 3, 5, 10. Okay, when a student is writing the program and is evaluating it, first what does the VPL do? It will give this case, case one first. So then the case one, the VPL tried to give to the program the input as 3, 5, 10. And what should the program should output? The output should be 10.0. Okay, so this is case one. So we are mentioning for this input, okay, if a program is written by a student and it is getting evaluated, okay, what is actually VPL doing is VPL takes first case. Okay, so many cases will be there. It will be taking the test case one and it will give the input. What is the input here? 3, 5 and 10. Okay, it will give the input 3, 5 and 10 to the program. And the program should give an output, right? Okay, and check whether, and the VPL will check whether the program is giving the output 10. This is how the VPL is evaluating a student's program. Did you get any idea? Means something you get, right? So once you do, then only you will get a correct understanding. But what I am trying to explain is that the evaluation of a student's program is merely depend upon the test cases. Okay. Obviously, whatever the student is writing, they can see the output in the run button in the console. But the evaluation score purely depends upon the test cases. Okay, if the program satisfies all the test cases, then only the mark will be given. Otherwise, it won't be given. Okay, so if I am giving 4 test cases, what happens? The student will, or the program or the VPL will give each cases 1 by 1. So it will give the first case. Okay, check whether 3, 5 and 10 is the input, what is the output? If it is 10, this test passed. One test passed. Okay, then going to the test 2. The test 2, I have written some other, right? If 3 inputs are same, right? In the first case, I give only the positive numbers. And the second case, the different case, you have to write. That is, if what happens if all the numbers are same. Okay, so the test case 2, the VPL will give the all inputs are 3 and check whether the output is 3.0. If it is 3.0, test 2 also pass. Okay, and coming to test 3, what is that? It is having a positive and a negative number, right? Another case. What happened? The VPL again gives this particular case. If the input is 1000 minus 10,000 and 2000, what is the output? It should display 2000. It's the largest number, right? Yes. And if it is test 4, 4th is written, all the negative numbers. If all are negative numbers, it should give the output this minus 1000. Okay, so this 4 cases. So when you are writing the cases, we can see how you can write the cases, okay? All the cases are different. One is all positive numbers. The other one, all the 3 numbers are same. The third case, positive and negative numbers. And the fourth case, only negative numbers. So this way you have to write the test cases. The test cases should touch all the possibilities. Is that clear how to write the test cases for a number? Is that clear? Can I get a response from any one of you? And when you are writing the numbers, no need of double quotes and all. Okay, you just write 3, 5, and 10 in multiple lines. 3, 5, and 10. So this is how you can set it for the numeric problem. But the test cases, when you are setting the test cases, it should be very careful. Okay, so that is the one thing I want to tell you. And the grade reduction, and one more thing. The grade reduction I set here 100%, right? That's what's the meaning here. If this test case fails, reduce 100% score. Reduce 100% means no marks, the score will be 0. So here all the cases I have set the grade reduction as 100%. See, I have set all the cases grade reduction as 100%. Here also I can set grade reduction is equal to 100%. Then my question is, can we change the grade reduction to some other percentage, 20%, 30% or anything? Can we change? Can we change? Obviously, we can change. Yes. Then what is the importance of that? If I am changing to this to 20, okay. Okay, 25 I am writing and just changing, okay? Just changing 25. All this I am changing to 25.
Like if the answer is partial correct, then
yes,
the person should be getting some marks.
Some marks. So as of now, I already explained, no? As of now, what I explained is they will get a score only 0 or 100, right? Not other score won't be displayed. But if you are distributing your score among different cases, okay, if this particular test is passed, they will get a 25% score. And if it fails, what happens? A 25% score will get reduced out of 100. Is that clear? There is partial correction can be done. Okay, you can set, it is all up to you, teachers. If you want a student to score only either 0 or 100, you can do like that. Otherwise, if you want to make the student score, okay, what is the partially? Okay, suppose 0 marks or 25 marks, depending upon their program, you can set like this. You can set in the grade reduction technique. I think it's clear. Is that
well,
clear?
In my opinion, the VPL can be actually, like, it can be installed by the administrators, but it can be actually configured properly by the programming teachers only.
Yes.
Because
yes,
the others may not be able to, you know, put so many case, test cases and so many things there.
No, yes, Sandeep sir, you are right, because only the programming teachers can write. That's what I initially said. The initial setup phase is somewhat tricky. I'm not saying it's a serious job, it's somewhat tricky. Okay, you have to set, but once it is set, no, it is final. You don't want to change anything. It can be used by any number of users, it can be used by any number of students. But the initial setup phase is very critical. Okay, it can't be done from the administrator side or anybody. Only those teachers who are handling the programming, okay, those who are very good, who are taking the course in the programming courses, they can exactly do this. Okay,
ma'am, one more question is here. Can these assignments and tests and VPLs, can it be exported and imported as well or no?
Are you getting the marks and all?
No. I'm talking about
the file.
In a particular course, I have mentioned like so many assignments, so many resources and activities are there.
Okay. Right?
Now, I want to export it. I want to export it, in an external file, so that in some other case, like if something goes wrong, and if I need, so instead of, in case if I have to configure it again, so I don't have to, do all the thing again, and I can simply import these VPLs and assignments or activities.
Yeah, import option is there. You're asking like that, sir.
Right. Yes. So if the import is there, then the export should be also there. Because if the export is not there, the import.
Yes, because this is actually the demo where we tried initially.
Okay.
Okay. So from this, we just import this all to our courses.
Right.
You don't need to configure it again. I think that is what you are asking, right?
I'm sorry?
That is what you are asking, right?
Yeah, I'm asking that if these, these setups, these virtual labs can be imported and exported. If you have already made a very good virtual lab, which is working great.
Yes.
And suppose I request you to, that, ma'am, please give me your virtual lab. So is it possible for you to...
No. Inside only. See, inside in the Pathshala. See, suppose I am doing in the Pathshala, right? So can I... Will you serve? Okay. So that I wanted...
It must be possible. Like, we can do the plugins, but what about these VPLs? Like, because in that case, the teachers or administrators' life would be easy. Like, one will do the, a team will do... the hard work, and everyone will be benefited.
Yes,
everyone will be getting that
Yes, because I already started, I and myself, Vimal is there, my colleague. We started with this DPL, okay, initial stage in this platform, okay, the demo. You can see all this on demo.
Right.
And after that, we mapped, we imported all this to multiple courses, not only the courses which we are handling, but others also. We just imported this. That possibility is there. The initial setup is only the problem. It can be imported to so many courses.
I think I'm not able to clarify my question. My question is not within that particular system.
Oh, okay. It is not.
I'm talking about the inter systems.
No, like it is.
We have two Moodle instances, and if I want to export it from one instance and import it to the other one.
I think so. No.
Okay, we'll check it.
Yeah, because no, I think no, because I see some query in the forum also like that. I think so, sir. I want to check it once more. Okay. So, but internally you can do it. Okay. But here in the Pathshala, there is a server. I think we can export and import the data within one. I don't know. I am not sure, sir. I am not sure about VPL. Okay. Yes, sir. I am just telling VPL because VPL has so many drawbacks and those.
No problem. Sure.
Yes.
But course. apart from the VPL. The other resources other assignments which we create. Like my question bank, for an instance, I have created a question bank. Now, if I want to export my whole question bank and import it in some other instance of the Moodle, can I do that or not?
Yeah, I think it can be done, sir. Within Moodle server, we can.
Import. I think Riji sir can answer that in a more proficient way. Because
I didn't try it yet, sir.
What was the question? Can you repeat, Ashwati?
Yeah, actually, Sandeep sir is asking whether we can import and export an activity resources, one Moodle instance to another Moodle instance, a Moodle server actually.
Which means that the content that we add in one section can be imported to another
course.
So there are two ways. So one, I will tell both the possibilities. One question that you are asking right now, Ashwati created a course in the internal.ictkerala.org. That is actually a backup instance of Moodle. So now think that she wanted to move all these questions from this instance to our primary instance called retail.ictkerala.org. So in that case, how it works is you can take the backup of the course. So we will demonstrate how that can be done. And from the main course, we can take the backup and it will be loaded just like a zip file. You have a file created and you can store it in your local directory. Otherwise it will be there inside. You can anytime you can download. Then you log on to your actual the next instance of Moodle where you do the import. So that part we will demonstrate. So think that you wanted to move it. So you created some content in one course and you wanted to export that content into another course in the same Moodle instance. So there you don't have to take the backup and restore in the same instance, but you can selectively move content from one course to another course. So these two demonstrations that we will do, I think this is the question of Nilesh sir also mentioned that you can do the backup. Okay, I will show you how the backup can be done. Ashwati, can you do the demonstration? I will give you the instructions since you are sharing the screen.
Yes, that I will do. Okay. And one more question from Sridevi ma'am, the test cases we will set will not be visible. It will be visible right now, sir. Now, ma'am, actually, because I already show you, right? When they, I will just log in as a student. Give me 1 second because the test cases they can see. Because when you check the grade, no, in that you can see the output is this. What is the expected output? I think you see, right? Okay, so here this is the student's view. Suppose I am taking day 6, I will take. There's this largest of three numbers. So there you can see the edit tab, okay? So if you are writing the program here, okay, I'm just writing print out, okay? This is not a correct one. I'm just showing it for a demo. Okay, I'm just writing a program. It is not a program for minimum of two numbers, okay? Or the largest of two numbers. I'm just taking this. Just evaluating it. So it is 0 out of 100, right? So here they can see the test one failed and all. The submission view. They can see. Can you see Sridevi, ma'am? This is, they can see which test is failed. Okay. So this is the input the test case is giving. What the student program output is welcome, but what is the expected output is 10. But it is good to really know because the students will be able to understand where is the error. Okay, ma'am. So it is given for a, see, we are giving this for the students, but we can make this test cases invisible for the student also. But there you have to write some other code. Okay, I'm not going to do that. So that I will just share you a forum. So there it is available. But as of now, the students can see what are the test cases and what is their output and what is the expected output. So from this, the students will learn what is the mistake in their program. So they will always try to, okay, when the input is like this, the output should be like this. So from this, they will learn and they will correct the errors and they will again edit the program, again evaluate it, and they can build their or they can increase the score. I think it's clear, Sridevi, ma'am. Yes, okay. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. So I think that's clear, right? I will just demonstrate one or two programs. Then I'm just drawing the teacher side. So is that interesting? I'm asking for this. I know it is all for the programming background teachers will be benefited, but is it interesting? I'm asking you all because will it be helpful for evaluating the assignment? But won't the student be able to manage it to get output if test outputs are visible? Possible the case, different test case evaluation. And get it. But won't the student be able to manipulate the script?
No,
okay. Yes, they can manipulate the script, means they can change the script, okay, in order to get the record output. And that the test cases, we have to be very careful. Arun sir, that is a place where you should be very careful. The test cases, we have to be very careful. And there are provisions for not to display the test cases from the student's side. That possibility is also there. I'll share you a detailed document regarding this. As of now, it is actually all programming part. Okay, so I don't want to discuss all the programming stuff here. Okay, so that is what the thing. You can hide the test cases from the student, obviously. But if it is giving for a, was more into Python, to study more about Python in the programming, it is good to visible the test cases. I think it's clear, sir. Okay. And I will just show you one or two cases, okay? Okay, let me give 1 second. Okay. So some other programs, let me check. Okay, five. So this is all about some steps in Python, okay? So those who know Python, they can understand. Okay.
Actually, it's a good thing to share some one or two test cases, samples to them through the file.
Yes, sum of two numbers. Okay, the sum of two numbers. This is also test cases related to numbers, right? Okay. So this is a test case. So now there is somewhat another interesting thing is coming. Okay, so here this is one test case. This is another test case. And this is the third test case. What's the difference here? Here the case, you can give the case any name. The grade reduction is again 100%. If you want, you can change it for a partial output if you can. Then if the input is 10 and 20, you know the sum is 30, right? But instead of 30, I am giving like this. Can anyone tell me what is this? from the teachers from the programming background, they know what is this. And I will just tell you what is the importance of this. How, okay? Can anyone tell me? So here I am writing a simple case. Add two numbers, sum of two numbers. If I am giving 10 and 20 as the input, the output should be 30, right? But instead of 30, I wrote some special characters are there. Can anyone tell me what is that? Any idea? Okay, I will tell you. Suppose it is formatting. Yes, there's some formatting. Yes, Arun, so it is a type of formatting. I will tell you. Suppose a student is writing the program. Okay, and she is printing the result as the, okay, output may not be visible. No, output will be visible, ma'am. But the thing is that, consider a student is writing the program, okay, and she is printing the result as the sum of two numbers is 30. Okay, she is displaying the number. She is not just displaying 30 itself. She is displaying that the sum of two numbers is 30. In that case, okay, we are going for a regular expression. I don't know how many of you are familiar with regular expression, but I just want to tell you, this means that you can have any text or any white space or anything in the output, but this 30 should be in the last part of the output. That means if the output is like this, if the output is simply 30 itself, 30 also, it will work. If the output is like this, the sum of the two numbers is 30, then also the student should get the 100% score, right? Right? Am I clear? See, this is the case where you have to be more keen into the test cases. Okay, sometimes the student will display only 30. Okay, she will take two numbers A and B and she will display A plus B. Some students will be doing like that. But some students, what they will do? They will do A plus B and they will print. Okay, the sum of A and B is this much, right? So then also they should get a score. Okay, so for that you are using regular expression. You are using regular expression. So it is basically related to JavaScript. Okay, this is a regular expression format. So this means that the output can have any text, okay, any space or any text, but the last portion of the output should be 30. Okay, so in that case, so many methods are there in order to create the test cases. Is that clear? If you are giving only 30 means the output is, so suppose I am giving only output equals to 30 and the student is printing the sum of two numbers is 30, it won't be get the full marks. But this, his answer is correct, right? His program is correct. He is getting the correct output. But because of our test case, he or she is not getting the full score. So in order to avoid that, we have to use the regular expression. So I think the teachers related to programming courses understand, right? I don't know how much others understand. Did you get something from this regular expression? Without double quotes, we can give. Yeah, that's also we can give. You can go for any option. Without double quote means that particular 30 will be coming anywhere in the output. Okay, that also you can give. So many test cases are there. I won't be able to demonstrate all the test cases, okay, right now. So I'm just showing some of them. And I will discuss one more, okay? One more. Okay. So let me check. Day four. Okay, this one. This one I will show you. Okay. So this one, we have two files, requested files and execution files. Right now we discuss only execution files, right? That is, in the test cases, we can write like this. If this is one request is start the test at 11:15 sharp because some of us may have regular details like, okay, sir. Okay, I will wind up after this. Okay, don't be taking too much time. I know you are all working professionals. Give me some 2 more minutes. Okay, so I just want to discuss this also. Okay. So this is the test case. Okay, case test. Then if there is no input is there, I don't want to explain the program. there is no input, the output should be like this. The output should be like this. Okay. Here, I have the requested file join.py. I have a requested file join.py. And there is a template here. There is a template here. That means I am already written some code here. Okay. The teacher can give a template having small portion of the code. Okay. So from the student side, what they can see is when they open the edit tab, they can see the requested file like this join.py with the codes inside it. Already some codes are there, right? They have to fill the codes. Then only they will get the correct output. The one method I have shown is the student have to write the program completely. Okay, then they can run it and evaluate. The second one is a code filling type. That means the teacher can, you are already gone through HackRat and all, right? There you can see some code filling questions will be there. Exactly the same way, you can write the codes here, but not the full code. Here you can write favorite equal to, it is not complete one, right? So students have to complete it, then run it and evaluate. There's also one another option that you can do. A code filling type of questions can also be set in Rupier. So two types you can set. Either you can set for a whole program, you can ask the students to write it. Other, when you created the requested file, okay, you created this welcome.py, right? So at that time, you can write the code inside that, and that code will be given as a template for the students. So the students can delete that code, no issue, they can delete it. That is one case, that is another disadvantage of Rupier. There is no other option. I already posted a query in the forum because they had no other option. The only option is you can give the template. Okay, the students can write it inside the template or they can erase it and write it. But they will get an idea, right? If they are beginners, they are just starting to the Python or any other course, there will be a, say, it will be a great encouraging for the students. Okay, I have to write this only. They have to go through this. What are the variables declared here? And accordingly, they have to fill the codes and edit it and run it. So this is another option that can you add in the virtual programming. So I think I colored, I discussed almost everything, how to code with numbers, how to write a test cases using the text option, how to adjust the grade, okay, how to reduce the grade, how to write more than one test cases, okay, and how to make the students to write a complete program in the requested file, or you can give a setup like code filling also. So these are the major things that you can do. And I already mentioned the forum, right? So that forum is there. So this is actually the forum. I think you can see here, right? So I just logged into that. You can log in with the help of your Google mail ID, okay, Google account. So here I just log in and there you can post your queries. Okay, so when you are new to it, the ZPL, I really recommend you to go through this forum because so many questions are there. Okay. So sometimes the server will be error, you won't be getting. So that will be updated in the forum. And so many errors, so many questions will be there. See, problem with the test cases. So if you refer this, you will understand more about the test cases. Okay. So many things are there. I recommend you to go through this forum also to get a more idea about VPL. And the VPL documentation is there. Okay, you can get it from the Google. Here they explain how to create test cases. Okay, how to create test cases with the numbers, how to create test cases with the text, how to create exact text, right? This double quote, exact text, and there's a regular expression. So all these are mentioned here. And unfortunately, you won't be getting more material related to VPL, okay? So this forum is one of the good things where you can explore more and regarding to this VPL, okay? And I think you get an understanding of the VPL virtual programming platform, how you can do the, you can create a VPL program in the Moodle, how you can create the test cases, okay? From the student side also, I showed you. And the one thing is important, only the last attempt mark will be taken to the gradebook. Okay, I think you all know how to take the gradebook, right? So the gradebook, you can see all the marks. but only the last executed score will be added to the grade. So that's important, and you can explore more and more is there in the VPL. I just explained only the basic thing. Okay, so I request you, those who are interested in VPL, please explore more and make use of this forum for the more discussions and all. I couldn't find a more useful place now to get a more idea of VPL. So that's what I am sharing forum with you people also. If you post a query also, they will be reply. Okay, they will reply within 1 or 2 days. So they will get a mail also. Okay. So that, yeah, we just shared a link for the backup, right? Okay, thank you. Thank you for this. So I think from my end, it's over. So is there any query regarding this VPL?
Shruti, I would like to add one thing. I understand that most some of the teachers are not from a CS background. They may not find this particular VPL very, very useful for their courses. But on the other side, we know that you all represent an institution. So nowadays, coding is not a different skill. It's actually a necessary skill for everyone. If you study a science course or even an arts course, programming skill is these days a basic skill. So one thing that you can do is you can create an add-on course. And the beauty of this tool is you don't have to do any kind of evaluation. So it's coding, a student can learn only through practice. If you give as much opportunity to practice, that is the best thing that you can do to the students. So once you, if you are from a different background, take some help from the CS or IT teachers, set up this and give it to the students. So that actually is a good resource that you can share with the students. And once again, I assure you, it's actually 2 years, 2 hours is not enough for giving an introduction to, not a better introduction to VPL, but you did it from a base beginner level to an intermediate level. So that is a good effort, and one can become expert going through the forum and practice. So
yes, I one thing I want to tell you, I am also not an expert. Okay, I have also tried from my end, and my colleagues that Vimal is here, Gobu and some of the colleagues, we worked actually a lot. Okay, so as I said, you don't be getting any more materials regarding to the VPL more. So that the best platform is the forum, and Arun sir asked. With the open source language alone, or it will work with Matplotlib and all. So MATLAB, is it? So these are the programs where you can try, sir. I don't know, MATLAB is there. Okay. C and all are there, I think. Yes. Here you can find it, Arun, sir.
So one more thing that, like, once you set the problem statement and set the test cases, so you, when you look at the test cases, it is code independent, yes, right? MATLAB. It is, you are not writing a case study not for a particular code. So what will happen is, if you set it, the student can write it in any language. They can submit the solution in C, CPP, in whatever language that they know. So your duty is to set the problem statement and give the test cases, and student can choose any programming language, and there is a provision on the right top where they can choose the language and write it. So that's the beauty of virtual programming language.
Only difficulty is to write the test case. Okay, that's what I say. And Arun sir, this is a MATLAB is also supporting. Okay, MATLAB. And GUI interfacing is also there. So in the MATLAB, you will display more, say, graphs and all, right? So GUI interfacing is also there, Arun sir. I think it's clear, right, sir? Yes, okay, fine. So I am stop sharing now. If you are anything, you can ask me, okay? Because I will try to answer, okay? So this is the basic things regarding the VPL. You can go more and more. The only thing is, the trick is behind the test cases. Okay, how you are declaring the test cases, there lies the trick. Okay, I think you are clear with this. Any doubt? Okay, if not a doubt, sir, we can move, right?
Yes, I should. You can conclude.
Yeah. So I am really happy to be with you people, because I am with you from the day one itself. Okay. And this is the fifth day, and I am really happy that I got 2 sessions. One is about assignment, and this VPL is again a part type of assignment, right? Regarding to program. So I'm really happy to share my knowledge with you people. Okay. So really happy to be with you for these 5 days. Thank you so much. Thank you all.
Thank you, Ashwati ma'am. Thank you for such a beautiful and energetic session on virtual programming lab. Now let me invite Dr. Julie M. David, Assistant Professor, MES College, Marampally, for proposing the vote of thanks. Ma'am, please.
Thank you, Indu. Respected resource person, Ms.